This is my longtime favorite way to easily add a new variety to a citrus tree. But I've had the occasional failure when grafting this way. Because of the extremely hot weather that's been forecast, I fear that the grafts I'm about to do might also fail, wasting both my time and also the expensive budwood that I bought. So to enhance my chances of success, I'll try some improvements to this simple grafting technique that I've recently learned from an Australian citrus scientist. He's a very good grafter and he teaches farmers how to graft successfully. As I graft 7 new citrus varieties to this tree, I'll give different tips with each variety to help you succeed with your grafting. But if any of the grafts fail, we may be able to learn something, so we'll carefully examine the results of each graft later in the video. I have mandarin oranges growing on the tree now, but I'm going to prune off all of the mandarin branches and graft sour fruits instead. Here you can see graft unions where I grafted the tree before. The tree was originally a lemon tree, but I had more lemons than I needed, so I transformed it into a mandarin orange tree by grafting. This severe pruning creates a big problem that could ruin my grafts, but I'll show you how to avoid it. Bark newly exposed to sunlight is likely to crack and die. But there's an easy and inexpensive solution that I've learned from farmers: water-based latex paint. My local big box hardware store sells incorrectly mixed paint samples for only 50 cents. Many of these colors wouldn't be appropriate for a tree, but this white one will be perfect. But I wouldn't recommend this unless you can get your hands on paint that is not lead-based. Lead is a health hazard that you don't want in your garden, but fortunately, lead-based paint has long been banned in many countries, including the US. I add the same amount of water to make a mixture of half paint and half water. With this first branch that I'm grafting, I'll show how to physically connect the scion of my first variety to the branch so that they'll heal and so that the new branch can grow. There's a thin layer of plant tissue called the cambium where the bark of the branch meets the wood. When we peel back the bark, there'll be cambium tissue both on the bark and also on the wood. For the graft to succeed, the cambium of the scion must touch the cambium of the branch in at least one point, but the more the better. This first cut is ideally about 2 inches long and exposes cambium of the scion that we'd like to touch the cambium that's on the wood of the branch that we've exposed. We'll also make a cut in the scion designed for cambium contact with the cambium on the bark of the branch. Long ago, I learned from a hobbyist to do this by shaving off some of the bark from the scion like I'm showing. But the Australian citrus scientist taught me to make a second cut to the scion like I'm showing here to create cambium contact with the bark of the branch. So I'm going to try this method of cutting the scion for the grafts of all 7 new varieties in this video. This type of graft is called a bark graft. When the branch is big enough, it's possible to increase the chance of success by grafting a second scion to the same branch. If I graft my scions in the wrong place, they'll die. So with the second variety that I'm grafting, I'll show both where to cut the branch and also where to insert the scions in the end of the branch. I'd like to graft to this branch, but there are several places where branches that had grown out of this branch would block my grafts. So I'll cut below the most troublesome ones to give myself a couple of inches where I can insert the scion. Intuitively, you might expect the cross-section of a branch of a citrus tree to be circular, but normally the cross-section of the branch will be a bit irregular, with some parts that are curved and other parts that are more flat. Cambium contact will be a little more difficult if the scion is grafted to a curved part. So I prefer to graft to a flat part of the branch. Mm-hmm. I'm worried that my scions might dry up and die. So with this third variety that I'm grafting, I'll explain how I hope to prevent this with a new method of wrapping scions. Because citrus must be grafted in hotter weather than easy to graft fruit trees such as apple and peach, it is critical to take measures to keep grafted citrus scions from drying out. I used to protect my citrus scions from drying out by wrapping them with a stretchy material called parafilm after grafting them, but I would leave the buds uncovered because I was worried that the buds would have trouble growing through the parafilm. That's how I grafted the mandarin branches to this tree 4 years ago, and it worked pretty well, but it was cooler then, and I'm not confident that it will work in the upcoming heat. Normally I'd wait for better weather, but for reasons I'll explain later in the video, I couldn't wait any longer to graft this tree. So I'm trying a new method of wrapping scions that I learned from the Australian citrus scientist. In order to be more efficient, scions are wrapped with parafilm before grafting, not after. Parafilm is wrapped over the buds, but to make sure that the buds can grow through the parafilm, it is important to wrap no more than one layer of parafilm over a bud. I want my graft to recover as quickly as possible and bear fruit. So with this fourth variety, I'll show a trick to make the graft heal faster. But first, I'll show the wrapping and sealing of the graft. Long ago, I learned to first wrap the graft with a layer of parafilm, but parafilm isn't strong enough to hold the graft securely. So I would follow that by wrapping with a rubber band to put pressure on the grafts, but rubber bands deteriorate in sunlight, so I would follow that with a second layer of parafilm to keep the rubber band from coming off. But I didn't want grafting seal to flow into the open ends and interfere with the healing of the graft, so I would also cover the top of the branch and the open ends with even more parafilm, which would allow me to safely apply grafting seal. This method's worked well for me, but occasionally I've seen cases where I discovered rot when unwrapping the parafilm, so I wondered if I might have used too much parafilm. Some people spray a fungicide on the graft area before wrapping to avoid this problem, but I'm going to try the new wrapping method I've recently learned without a fungicide, so I'll see if that avoids the problem. Unlike parafilm, this vinyl tape that I'm using to wrap the graft doesn't break easily when I pull on it, so it's possible to wrap it very tightly and force the cambium of the scion into close contact with the cambium of the branch. So I don't need multiple layers and can wrap the graft with only a single layer of vinyl tape. If my liquid grafting seal were to get in here, it could make it more difficult for the graft to heal, so I'll cover up this part with tape. In the past, I've used a grafting seal that's popular with farmers, but the product can be hard to find, and it is sold in much larger quantities than I need, so I've decided to try a readily available tree seal instead to see if it works as well. I hope that sealing both the end of the branch and also the end of the scion will keep the graft from drying out in the extreme heat that's been forecast. When I inserted the scion, did you wonder why I left a cut portion of the scion above the end of the branch here? The reason for this is to get the graft to heal faster by encouraging callus tissue to grow from the scion and cover the end of the branch. If the graft succeeds, we'll follow up and see how well that works. The weather is very hot, so with this fifth variety I'm grafting, I'll explain a few more tricks to overcome the heat. On a hot day like today, my grafts could easily dry out and die if I grafted at the wrong part of the day, so I'm grafting first thing in the morning for two reasons. First of all, because it's cooler, and secondly, because there's no direct sunlight to dry out the graft. But today, first thing in the morning, it's still pretty hot, so I'm doing my best to graft quickly so that the grafts don't dry out before I wrap them. Another factor that affects the chances of success is the time of year. Citrus grafts heal best when the temperatures are in the 70s or 80s, so my preference is to graft citrus in the spring when temperatures are first getting in that range. Those temperatures make citrus trees more challenging to graft than other types of fruit trees. But unfortunately, it's late June and the forecast temperatures are much higher than I would prefer. Normally I'd wait and hope for cooler weather, but tomorrow morning I'm leaving on a month-long trip with my family and I doubt that the weather will be better when I get back. If I had been grafting in the spring, applying this grafting seal would be the last step because the parafilm wrapped around the scion would be enough to keep it from drying out. But in this weather, I'm going to have to cover the scions to avoid direct sunlight. Some people use a paper bag for this step, but I prefer aluminum foil because it reflects the sunlight so well and it's easy to secure. With this sixth variety that I'm grafting, I'll show you how I'm avoiding the fate of this lemon tree, which was removed after being infected with a deadly citrus disease. This tree was infected by the disease as a result of being grafted with many other citrus varieties, including an exotic pomelo. A viewer from Greece highly recommended that I grow this Greek lemon, so I want to try it, but it's rarely grown in California and nurseries don't sell the trees. But I don't want to infect my tree with the disease by grafting a diseased cutting.
Florida citrus is fighting for its life.
Diseases have wiped out nearly 95% of their orange crop.
This is called citrus greening disease. It's killing trees and it's happening right now in Florida and California. It's caused by a bacterium transmitted through an aphid-like insect, which infects the tree, killing it.
Huanglongbing will kill your citrus tree, and there's no cure.
Even if I knew someone growing this lemon variety, the presence of the Asian citrus psyllid requires a new assumption.
If you have a backyard tree like this, it may be infected.
So I've ordered all of my citrus budwood from a California program called the Citrus Clonal Protection Program, or CCPP. They cut their budwood from trees that are both tested to be disease-free and also protected from disease-spreading insects inside of an insect-proof screen house. And they have budwood of hundreds of interesting citrus varieties available to order. So by using this disease-free budwood program, I can graft many citrus varieties to my tree and be sure that I'm not infecting it with a deadly disease. Certified disease-free budwood programs like the CCPP exist in every continent where citrus is grown, and you can learn more about them at fruitmentor.com/citrusbudwood. With this seventh and final variety, I'll explain how to store citrus budwood without ruining it. I think this budwood should be okay, but I'll show you a couple of things that I've done wrong. Budwood will be ruined if it isn't stored properly. Here you see me grafting some budwood that I didn't store correctly. I'm more optimistic about the grafts that I'm doing today because I did a better job storing the budwood. When I received the budwood, I immediately refrigerated it in the sealed bags in which it arrived. Stored this way, budwood can be good for several months, but the likelihood that a graft will succeed will gradually decline. The condition of this budwood isn't ideal because I received it 5 weeks ago, so this is another reason I didn't want to wait another month to graft this tree. But I have successfully grafted using citrus budwood stored for much longer. The time I ruined my budwood, I noticed that my refrigerator was a bit colder than it ought to be, so I tried storing it in the cooler with some ice instead. But I would have been much better off if I had adjusted the refrigerator and double-checked the temperature before receiving the budwood. During my trip, I'd occasionally wonder if I'd failed and my grafts were dying, or if I'd succeeded and I'd be setting up some time-lapse cameras to catch their growth. But now I'm home, so let's take a look. For the first variety, I had grafted two scions. Upon removing the foil, we could see that the first scion that I had grafted is green, but not yet growing, and the second scion is brown and dead. Let's take a closer look at the dead one when I remove the vinyl tape 6 months after grafting. I suspect that the graft failed because there wasn't enough cambium contact with the cut portion of the scion. The graft that succeeded had a fairly long cut, but the one that failed had a shorter cut, so I wonder if it might have succeeded if I had cut it longer. So far, my grafting success rate is only 50%, but I'm happy because I succeeded with the variety that I wanted on the branch that I wanted. At the end of the video, I'll show the overall success rates for the whole tree. For the second variety, I had grafted two scions. Both were still green when I unwrapped them, but it was still hot and I was a little worried that the black tree seal might generate too much heat in the sun. So for all of my grafts, I painted over the grafting seal with white paint, but I'm not sure that this was necessary. 2 weeks later, both grafts had started to grow, but then the first graft started to grow much faster than the second graft. 6 months after grafting, they are both still growing, but the first graft is doing much better than the second graft. Looking back at when I had grafted them, you can see that the first scion had a longer cut than the second scion and thus more cambium contact. For the third variety, I had grafted two scions. Upon unwrapping, both are brown and dead, so let's see if we can figure out why they failed. At first, it isn't obvious, but when I was grafting, I didn't have a clear view of the other side of this branch from where I was standing. But I did have another camera recording from the other side that shows that I broke this bark flap open, ruining my cambium contact. If I had noticed, I could have either put the scion in the other bark flap, which was intact, or started over on another branch since I had more branches than varieties to graft. Looking at the second scion, I see that I had cut the end a little shorter than I should have. In hindsight, I should have discarded the second scion after the poor cut and cut a third scion since I had an extra. With this fourth variety, I grafted only one scion. Let's see if it healed like I hoped it would. It's still green after 4 weeks, which is a good sign. 2 weeks later, it's already growing fast. 6 months after grafting, the new branch is much thicker and callus tissue has grown over much of the open wound. With this fifth variety, I grafted only one scion. It was green when I unwrapped it, and it stayed green for a long time, but it did not grow. Here you can see the original lemon tree trying to come back, so when adding varieties to a tree like this, it's necessary to persistently remove sprouts from the original tree so that they don't overtake the grafted branch. 6 months later, the graft was dead. I'm not sure what went wrong with this one, but in hindsight, I see a few things that I should have done differently. I see that I did a poor job sealing the graft, so maybe when the rainy season started, water got into the graft and that killed it. Because of the previous graft union, there wasn't a good place for a backup scion on this branch, but I had plenty of other good branches that I could have chosen. Either of these two branches would have been a much better choice, but with more branches than varieties to graft, I ended up sawing them off in the end, so I should have chosen one of them and grafted two scions, not one. For the sixth variety, I had grafted two scions. After seeing my failure so far, I wonder if I should have made a longer cut on the end of this smaller scion for my second graft, but let's see what happened. After 4 weeks, both are still green, but not yet growing. When uncovered, they both started growing very fast. After 6 months, both were growing, but the second graft, which had been smaller in diameter and had had a shorter cut at the end, was actually now larger in diameter and healing faster than the first graft. We'll take a look at the results for the seventh variety here, and then we'll look at the overall success rates for the whole tree. Now you may be wondering, why did I graft lemons to this tree after I had already transformed it into a mandarin tree? Choices like this are an important aspect of citrus grafting, but it's not at all obvious how to make them. So I've made another video to explain. So click here and I'll help you to understand which variety to graft to which tree, and I look forward to seeing you in that video. With success rates like this for the whole tree, I'll definitely be using this technique again.